In a previous video, we looked at the Epson HX20, a revolutionary computer from 1982 that sent shockwaves through the computer industry due to its unique form factor as a small, portable computer with a built-in liquid crystal display. Tandy saw the Epson HX20 and thought, we can do better than that. And by March of 1983, they had. Hi, I'm Jacob with Tandy Lab, and today we're going to be taking a first look at the Tandy 100. Okay, first and foremost, that dramatic intro isn't strictly correct. The reason why? Well, Tandy didn't design the Tandy 100. It's actually an OEM design created by Kyocera. Both the Olivetti M10 and the NEC's PC8201 and PC8300 would be licensed from the same design, although each of these systems has their own quirks and oddities. Still, the Tandy design would prove the most successful by far. Even Kyocera's own model, the Kyotronic 85, struggled to sell. In fact, the Tandy 100 would become one of Tandy's best-selling computers ever, selling over 6 million units in its life. Keep in mind, this is still really early for this form factor of computer. But I have to say, with Tandy's model, they were able to pick out the individual elements of the machine that were important to focus on, and which areas didn't matter much to the type of consumer who would find use in this system. Some areas this system really succeeds in are the very large screen, having 8 lines of 40 characters, and the stellar battery life, generally around 20 hours. Areas that were cut down to make this possible were the CPU speed and the lack of good storage options at launch. When this system launched, it was called the Micro Executive Workstation, emphasizing its usability for the businessmen who needed a portable computer they could take with them on their red-eye flights from New York to Chicago. From what I can tell, the business world just wasn't interested, and the system quickly was rebranded to just being the Tandy 100. Interestingly enough, the Tandy 100 did find a niche, not with CEOs, but with journalists. This was a real benefit to Tandy because Tandy really struggled to curry favor with journalists most of their lifetime. All of a sudden, the same journalists who constantly were hard on Tandy, some would say even biased against them, were writing their articles on Tandy machines, and this had noticeably positive effects on their coverage of Tandy's products. Journalists praised the system for its battery life, screen size, quality word processing software, extremely quick boot-up times, and convenience. It was really easy for a reporter to take one of these with them and write notes while listening to an important press conference. Then on the flight home, they could use the same system to write up the full article. Another nice feature was that you could connect the Tandy 100 using its 300 baud modem to a phone line to send over your story to HQ to get the scoop earlier than your competition. No open phone lines around? Don't worry, Radio Shack also sold an optional acoustic modem, so you could connect the 100 through an already installed phone handset. Bit of a side note here, but when I was doing my initial research for this episode, I came across this Radio Shack catalog page for the 100, which showed some of the optional accessories. One of these was the acoustic modem, and I have to admit, when I saw it, I had no idea what it was. I'd never heard of them. I had to ask my dad what an acoustic modem was. Since pretty much the only thing you'd be using this computer for is word processing, having a good keyboard was essential, and Tandy hit it out of the park. This is one of the best keyboards I've ever used on a portable system. Journalists praised it up and down for its quality, with the only criticism being how loud the key actuation was, which was actually a pretty big problem for them. You don't want to call attention to yourself when you're, I don't know, reporting on a celebrity's funeral. Many journalists would have their systems modded to add dampening rings to the keys to keep them quiet. The Tandy 100 also saw plenty of use in the industrial sector. It was a great system for inventory managers, and it was fairly easy to wire one up to interact with existing machinery. They were also the first portables really durable enough to handle the type of stressful environment they would be put in. I have to say, I've messed around with many of these small portable systems, like the Epson HX20, Tandy's offerings, and tons of ripoffs. I even used a similar size word processor through high school. And I have to admit, the Tandy 100 might just be the best out of all of them. We got a real good deal on our two, yes, two Tandy 100s. We bought both together with two power supplies, all the manuals for the system, and one very nice faux leather carrying case for just $70 shipped. That's pretty impressive considering most single units sell for far more than that. On the top of our system, you'll see the LCD screen, TRS-80 badge, function and cursor buttons, and the keyboard. On the right side is the power switch, display contrast wheel, and the DC in. On the back is a reset button, RS-232 serial port, printer port, modem out, and cassette port. On the bottom is the battery cover and a covering to access the additional RAM and ROM sockets. One important feature is the inclusion of a full-featured version of Microsoft Basic 80. It features full pixel addressing, commands for communicating through the serial and modem ports, sound control, access to tape and RAM files, and support for the real-time clock. It's one of the best Basic implementations I've seen on such a low-powered system. One legendary fact about this is that according to Bill Gates himself, the Tandy 100 was the last system that he actually worked on programming himself, before he no longer had time due to, you know, having to be the boss of a major tech company. The Model 100 was promoted as being able to run up to 20 hours and maintain memory up to 30 days on a set of four AA batteries. It could not run from nickel-cadmium rechargeable batteries, but a hardware mod was available that made that possible. There are a ton of accessories for the Tandy 100 to be on the lookout for. There's the official cassette interface, the much later Tandy portable disk drive, which lets you use 3.5-inch floppy disks in 100K and later 200K double-sided allocations. There's also the aforementioned acoustic modem, which is quite an anachronism today, and the disk video interface expansion box, a dock for the system released in 1984 that adds 5.25 disk support and the ability to display the Tandy 100 on a CRT display in either 40 or 80 column mode. Pretty cool stuff. There's a fair amount of modern development for the 100, from modern homebrew software to RAM upgrades, up to 4 megabytes, to modern I/O like SD card readers, to some great emulators of the system, including the very impressive Cloud T, a JavaScript-based emulator that runs natively in your web browser. It's pretty sweet. The line started with the Tandy 100 would continue with several new models, none of which would quite reach the 100's success. First is the Tandy 200, a fully compatible direct successor with a new clamshell form factor closer to a traditional laptop that was released in 1984. Then there's the Tandy 600 from 1985, which is arguably not a part of the line, but we'll get into that in its own video. And finally, the Tandy 102, a return to the Tandy 100's original form factor from 1986 that cut costs, thickness, and weight while fundamentally being the same system. And now for the ratings. Usability gets a 5 out of 5. It's a system that was specifically sold on its usability and convenience. In addition, you have an avid community nowadays making modern accessories for it like the NADS box, a floppy drive emulator for SD card storage, and the Rex line of ROM and RAM expansion. Rarity gets a 1 out of 5. This is one of the most common systems by Tandy you can find online. This is due both to the high sales of the system and the fact that it's an absolute tank and the vast majority of them are still working today. Price gets a 3 out of 5. Prices for the 100 are on the rise. You probably won't get an incredible deal like we did. Aesthetics get a 3 out of 5. Although the 100 is a bit bland, it's inoffensive. In a way, it's a system that was designed to blend into the background, and it succeeds there. Software gets a 3 out of 5. Although software actually released by Tandy was kind of lacking, there's tons of modern homebrew to be found. And that's our review for this video. Be sure to subscribe because we've got a video coming out pretty soon for the Tandy 100 successor, the Tandy 200. You don't want to miss that. And if you'd like to, you can support us on Patreon to help keep the lights on. And join our Discord server so you can talk to me directly about your experiences using this system. And I'll see you guys next time.